stand.
Through the constellations in all their splendour,
and stars in their myriads into the endless velvet depths of space.
God of creation, who fashioned earth and sea and skies, who shaped the mountains, coasts and valleys, seeking out places we could recognise as home.
Teach us to see you through the glories of creation. Lift our eyes above the boundaries of far horizons.
Ever moving onward, I will see you moving nearer, closer to your beating heart.
Call me to follow you, and I will convey your truth. Always keep me faithful.
When failure spreads a cloud of gloom above us, and fogs of apathy confuse our every step, and when the endless drifts of mizzle douse the burning, glowing embers of our faith.
Lord, hear our cry.
When the demands of life encroaching on quiet moments, when pressures grind our spirits into dust, when time dries up like water in a desert, and prayer is pushed into more mere words like dried up husks.
Lord, kindle the flame.
Bring me to
follow you, and I will obey your truth. Always keep me faithful.
Lord of our Celtic yesterdays and hope of bright tomorrows,
feed the fire.
Empower your people once again.
Lift us from futile passivity or clinging to the rocks of ages past.
Strike joyous freedom, brave and bold to face this day.
We leave our outgrown shells beneath the tide of the half-forgotten dreams and monuments to pride of our other years.
The living Christ calls, follow me, and asks, do you really love me more than these?
Dare me to follow you, and I will obey your words. Always keep me faithful.
Adieu, nem abandonas da servius perum, de la vera incerno ranca blasco, grondin in truede, my laverin in leo ragus gene, of el cares of orion cans da bad Jesu Christ, and of you harangue against gene, in unses and spirit sands, undu, tranquet orphan. Amen. God, who sent your servant Piran to work in Cornwall for your kingdom, mercifully grant that we may faithfully labour for you as fellow workers of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
So we listen to our first reading.
A reading from Isaiah chapter 51. Listen to me, my people, and give heed to me, my nation, for a teaching will go out from me, and my justice for a light to the peoples. I will bring near my deliverance swiftly. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will rule the peoples. The coastlands wait for me, and for my arm they hope. Lift up your eyes to the heavens, and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens will vanish like smoke, the earth will wear out like a garment, and those who live on it will die like gnats. But my salvation will be forever, and my deliverance will never be ended.
So let's pray together. Lord Jesus, through you, the word of life, the Father brought all creation into being. Through you, the light of the world, the message of love, forgiveness, and eternal life was brought to the world. The darkness could not extinguish the light, and after your crucifixion, you rose again to life. Through the power of your Spirit, the world is dead. That same message is spread across our world. Show me the part you want me to pray in your prayer.
not proclaim ourselves, we proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and ourselves as your slaves for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who said, let light shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in clay jars, so that it may be made clear that this extraordinary power belongs to God and does not come from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be made visible in our
in this song, St. Piran, St. Piran. It was written by Bridget England from Penzance for the children in her school. It's a lovely jolly song, and we thought it'd be good to sing it. And it tells the story of St. Piran very nicely. So the choir are going to sing the chorus, and then if you'd like all to have a go at it, it's dead easy. And then we'll start again, and we'll all sing the chorus together, and then the choir will sing the verses. Thanks, Lorraine.
Thank you.
I asked for that, didn't I? So the Holy Gospel is written in the Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 8. On that day, when evening had come, Jesus said to the disciples, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great gale arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Thanks be to God for these words from his Holy Gospel.
Margaret, do we have anybody down to preach?
By the grace of God, may I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Sometimes, goodness can so upset other people that it causes them to resort to do evil things. I don't know why I'm looking at you, Mr. Spann, but I just feel drawn.
But it is, isn't it? People get so cross, and then it leads them to do that which they wouldn't normally do.
The story of St. Piran's journey to Cornwall, bits of it must be a little bit exaggerated and fanciful, but then since when has that stopped the Church of England? Is rooted in this understanding. It is said that the pagans of Ireland were so afraid of St. Piran's natural authority and envious of his influence on their people that they took him to a cliff top, chained him to a millstone, and threw him over to the sea into a howling gale. And immediately the wind died down to a gentle breeze, the rough sea calmed, and his enemies saw Piran sitting on the stone, floating on the water. The goodness of St. Piran caused the evil of his community, and yet in the end that evil did not prevail. Goodness will prevail, maybe in a different place, maybe in a different time. The story of Sodom and Gomorrah is a case in point, and I was minded when I wrote that sentence that the last time Bishop Tim, who was a former Bishop of Truro, preached in Newquay, he did refer to Newquay as Sodom and Gomorrah, which is why it was the last time I invited him. In Sodom and Gomorrah, their drunken debauchery was the culture of the time, and they got destroyed. But out of them came new beginnings in the form of Lot and his family. Unfortunately, not Lot's wife, who looked back at the good old days and got turned to a pillar of salt. But that is for another sermon. St. Piran then embraced this new community in the new landscape of Cornwall that he found himself living in, and he would never have survived unless he had taken note and adapted of the people and the culture and the land around him. This refugee was thrown out of his own country, crossed the sea on a makeshift boat, adapted and became a positive member of the community of the people of North Cornwall. There is a novel by Philip Pullman called The Northern Lights, but for those of you who are film buffs, it's more commonly known as The Golden Compass, a film starring Daniel Craig. And it's the story which follows the journey of Lara, and Lara holds the Golden Compass. And the Golden Compass is a machine which tells the truth. The story is set in a world where the authority is the magisterium who destroyed all truth that is not their own truth. They have banned the golden compass because the truth that can't be controlled by them, they perceive, is dangerous. They don't do independent thinking. They don't do changes of mind. They just do, we belong to do it this way. The golden compass tells us the truth, or rather tells the interpreter the truth. And it highlights 3 points on the compass and how those points relate. And whatever those points are is dependent on what question is asked. And the problem with the question is, if you hold the question too tightly, you cannot see the answers. So you have to hold the question very lightly, very gently, as if the question itself is alive. That is, if we hold our questions to God too tightly, it means we are asking God to give us the answer that we want. But if we treat that question like it is something so precious, then the answer can be whatever the answer needs to be. The problem is with prayer, is that we pray expecting the answer we want. Now, we have to discover the truth, whether we believe in some higher being or whether we don't. And for those of the Christian faith, we believe that that truth is somehow made manifest in Jesus. And there is people that have written massive tomes on that, and no one quite can agree on how that works. But what we don't want to do is confine Jesus. We don't want to confine God. We don't want to confine the Bible. All these have far bigger interpretations and understandings and comprehendings than we can possibly imagine. And the problem is that because we don't feel safe, we confine them into, well, God says this, Jesus says that, the Bible says this. And we believe life is so much more than that. And God has given us the fullness of life, so much that we haven't even got a tiny little bit of the story that is the human story. In management speak, we are taught to see the larger picture. We are taught to think out of the box. And yet somehow, when suddenly we turn up on a Sunday morning, we stop doing that. We have to discover the truth that is the divine truth. And we have experiences of God, our own life's experience. And every single one of those life's experiences are relevant. And we need to see who we are in the context we live in, the signs of the times, to understand our own personal situation and how we relate to others, to try and find something that is the truth. Too often, we want to blame other people for our own actions, for our own decisions. But we cannot. And in this community, the community that St. Piran loved, we cannot take a stand and let other people do nothing. We cannot let others take a stand and let us do nothing. But rather, when we're not quite sure what to do, we still embrace the problems that are within our community, the problems that others have. We cannot decide what the answer is. I've been helping out a management company restructure itself, which, for those of you who know me in the church, is quite bizarre, isn't it? I can restructure and help out another company. I can't do it for myself, but I can do it. And I got brought in because it all fell apart. Because basically, the chief executive officer already decided what he wanted the staff's answers to be.
which may sound a bit stupid, really, but he honestly thought that he knew best. So I've had to come in and say, no. If you're going to do a staff consultation, it means you actually have to listen. And he said, but what happens if they want to take the company down another line? I said, whoa, you're being too black and white. You're not saying that what the staff want will happen. What you're saying is you want to hear what the staff feel. Don't think about the next stage. Don't think about the direction you're going to go in and the end result that you want. Perhaps you just listen first. And he said, well, what's the point of that? I said, because in the end, you may learn something. And in the end, the staff actually may recognize that you are in a no-win situation. And if they recognize that you're in a no-win situation, you may then win some of them back to your side. We cannot decide at the beginning what we want to see the end as. And the end is something that is made up of us all. It is made up of the St. Pirans who get cast aside from their community. It is made up of the indigenous people whom St. Piran came to be with. So the three points of our compass all need to come together. We have our intellectual capabilities. We have our hearts full of love. And we have the liberation of the faith of St. Piran that says, you are loved. And because you are loved, you should love. And in loving, you help those around you. And when you help those around you through love, you are helping God. That is why we are here. That is the Christian community he founded. A man who was banished from his own country, and the evil that beset him found a goodness in a new way. And he glimpsed, and those around him glimpsed, the face of God. That is what we're all about. That is what we do on a Sunday. That is what we do on our weekdays, every second of our lives, to search for the glimpse of God, not knowing what God looks like, but trying to find God in the small things, not just the big things. And we find God in the orphan and the stranger, the widow and the refugee, those who are privileged to have a home here, and those for whom, like St. Piran, travelled on the sea on a makeshift boat and found a calmness that is of God.
For to rob and to plunder it is our
we roam through the valley, where the lily and the roses and the beauty of Kashmir lay drooping its head.
Then away,
oh, then away,
then away,
oh, then away, then away, to those caves in yonder mountains where the robbers retreat. Hark, hark, in the distance there's footsteps approaching. Stand, stand, and deliver, it is our watch cry. As we roam through the valley, where the lily and the roses and the beauty of Kashmir lay drooping its head.
Then away,
oh, then away,
then away,
oh, then away, then away, to those caves in yonder mountains where the robbers retreat. Tawek, Tawek, Gani Glawek, trust our traitors of Nessa. Selek, Selek, Adasko, Labona, Kordi. And he owed their train and soul, mighty land, Blurgeno, and lilies and reali and rose and Newquay.
Do the blessed,
oh, do the blessed,
do the blessed,
oh, do the blessed,
do the blessed.
we celebrate the feast of St. Piran, we thank you that you came to Cornwall to spread the good news to our people. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
On this, our patron saint's day, we pray for all who live in Cornwall and all who love her, and for whom this is a special place. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We thank you for all who work to preserve and celebrate our culture, both here and across the world, and those who interpret it for today. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We thank you for those who work for Cornwall in government, in business, and in voluntary capacities. Pray that you will give them wisdom and discernment as they make decisions which affect us all. Lord, hear us. We thank you for the enthusiasm and desire to promote Cornwall and her culture across the Cornish diaspora, and pray for their safety and prosperity. Lord, hear us.
Lord,
as we celebrate together across Cornwall and the diaspora, we pray that the story of St. Piran will inspire us to follow his example and to work for the coming of your kingdom, O God, in this nation and this county of Cornwall. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
Merciful Father, accept our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And now we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. If you can pray it in Cornish, do. If you want to pray it in English, do so also. Agatasni, Urs Hinnin, Linigis Ribul Baha, Redlefron Bahwasko, Bahwod Ribul Riz, Minor Kepar Hagindin, Rol Linihevu Agatbara Pugdilol, Gavlin and Cameron, Kepara del Evin Nini, the Renners of Camel Air and Pinney, and Ara and Gora and Temptasi, there's the Lear Lee in North Jorga, Ragnizo G, Mamasco, and Gallos, Cambodians, Mispican and Habinari.
When things seem good and all our works yield harvest, and service at last is crowned with rich success, when all our work is bathed in earthly glory, help me remember my beginning and my end is you.
Set me upon you, I will obey your truth.
To ride the rocks across life's adverse seas, to see the silver in the boulders dark and barren. Release potential. Follow where you lead.
To take your life into the lifeless places.
To plant your word where ignorance quenches hope.
To surf the waves of opportunity and adventure.
To journey on, where your presence guides us, nourished by your life.
And finding hope in spirit, word, and prayer.
I will still follow you. I will obey your truth. With all my heart, I thank you. Always keep me faithful.
Before we go, I have something special to do. I have some banns of marriage to publish. Banns of marriage have to be pronounced at the principal service in the church on a Sunday. Am I right, Chris? Yeah, I am. So I publish the banns of marriage.
Are they here? Are they here?
I don't know. Are they here?
Who are they? Well, they would know.
Oh, yes. Both of this parish. If any of you know any cause or reason in law why these two people should not be joined together in holy matrimony, you are to declare it.
They were holy this morning.
Right.
And I did try and put him off.
It didn't work.
Well, we'll find out later. I'm getting afraid of it. I can tell you, look at the state of me, I'm only 30.
Well, look at the state of me, I'm only 21. So this is for the third time of asking. Shall we just pray for them? Heavenly Father, we pray for Daniel and for Naomi as they prepare for their marriage. We pray that you will bless them richly during their time of preparation on the day and in every day of their life together. May their life be rich and fulfilling, love-giving, both to each other and to those whom they meet. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we stand for the blessing. Just come to the English bit. I'll do the chorus, you do the English. Joy hacres peren redrico genum, arnum da serhis sa selvias peren regas kilchio gansigrenzum, du martis peren regas venicum, hagas quifum, and re agenumi, lemin habis vicum. Amen.
The joy and peace of St. Piran abide with you. The risen Lord and Saviour of St. Piran encircle you with his love. And the wonderful God of St. Piran bless and protect you and those whom you love, now and always.
Amen.